Hey bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey bananas, we want your movie. Driving June buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey bananas, we think you're groovy. We love to watch you cause you're our favorite show.
Hey bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey bananas,
hey bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hi everyone, and welcome to Plastic EP Live. Yep, here we are, and we're going to be doing a lot of talking. We've got Leslie Cavendish, hairdresser to the stars. He was on the Magical Mystery Tour in 1967. We got Paul from London with the 60s swinging tour. We got Natalie with us, and we got Mr. Shampoo. And before we start, let's have a look at the 60s swinging tour. Now, let's get back to the 60s swinging London tour. Now, Paul Endicott, tell me about the big event that's happening. I'm going to put it up now. Tell everyone about that, please.
Well, it's tomorrow. Tomorrow, at Saturday the 16th at 2 o'clock London time, or UTC, Greenwich Mean Time, we're doing our B Beatles in West London tour, which you saw the video for there. And we'll be visiting all of those locations in West London that was relevant to the Beatles. So Twickenham Studios, we're going to be finishing on the banks of the River Thames in Richmond, where the Beatles had their last photographs taken in Richmond in 1969. We'll be starting off at Chiswick House and Garden, where they filmed Rain and Paperback Writer. So many other locations that we'll be visiting. We'll be going down to the Crawdaddy Club location in Richmond, where the Beatles first met the Rolling Stones on the 14th of April 1963. And it was George Harrison that was instrumental in helping the Rolling Stones get out to Decca Records. And we'll tell you more about that on the tour tomorrow, so you've got to make sure you're on it.
And who's actually on the, who's going to do the narration of the tour?
Well, I'll be doing some of it. We got a fab top London tour guide, a guy called Adam, who will be at home base. He'll be in Mission Control at his house in North London, just a stone's throw from where the Kinks started off. And he'll be co-hosting the event with me and showing photographs, playing old videos, and showing locations of where we are in relation to central London. So it's a really immersive. Leslie's been on it. And it's one of our best. We do two others. We do the Swinging 60s Experience, which goes down the King's Road. Leslie's been on that a few times. We stop outside what used to be Apple Tailoring on the King's Road, where Leslie used to work as the hairdresser to the stars, not just the Beatles, but the Bee Gees and many, many others. And we also stop at other fashion locations down the King's Road. So that's the Swinging 60s Experience. And it's all about the culture, the fashion, and the music of the 60s. And then the Sunday tours is always the birth of the Rolling Stones down at Richmond upon Thames, their spiritual home, where they, and we start off that tour where they played in a church hall with the first time they played with a lineup with Charlie Watts and Bill Wyman. Amazing.
Can I ask you, Ian Stewart was playing piano, yeah?
He was until Andrew Lou Goldham came in and said, "Get out, you're not a Rolling Stone. You don't look the part." Unfortunate. He still played keys in recordings and some gigs, but he wasn't the line. He wasn't in the lineup. Andrew Lou Goldham said, "You just don't look the part," which was sad. He was a good chap. Lovely stories about where they used to rehearse at the Bricklayers in Soho. And old Stu used to turn up on his push bike to play keys. The keyboard was up there, but he came up on his push bike and he played beside the window so he could keep an eye on his push bike at the bottom of the Bricklayer's Arms in Soho, just to make sure nobody stole his push bike. A friend of mine...
Paul, I just want to ask you, if you can tell everybody the link right for tomorrow's tour, just give out the link to everyone.
Yeah, you can reach it on www.60sbus.london. That goes to our website and you can follow the links there.
Now, Leslie's going to be there. I'm going to be there. It looks like everyone's going to be there. I think Natalie's going to be there. So it looks like we're going to have a full house. Now, I know it's a fantastic tour. A great thing is you don't have to leave home. You get to see all this tour right in the comfort of your own home on your own computer. And, I mean, how do you beat that? Look how much money you save right there. Isn't that right, Paul?
You'll be able to see the snow falling in London live, and that's brilliant. Yeah, no, it's live, but you feel like you're there.
And you know what? The best thing is if you're in the United States, just make yourself a nice old English tea. Sit down and get ready to enjoy the heart of London. So you can't beat that, can you? Now, Leslie, I just want to ask you if I can. This is the Magical Mystery pre-show. We'll be talking about the album in another show. But I just want to ask you, Leslie, if you can please tell everybody about your experience. In 1967, you were on the Magical Mystery Tour bus. Now, I just want to sort of fill everybody in. Brian Epstein had passed away. And within 2 weeks, you were on the Magical Mystery bus. So just tell me what actually happened there, the concept about this Magical Mystery Tour, and just fill us in from, unfortunately, after Brian Epstein passed away.
Okay, so good evening, everybody, or good morning and afternoon. So basically, I'm going to go on with my Magical Mystery Tour that happened to me, which I never expected. I just was working, and I get a phone call. I knew Brian Epstein died. 2 weeks later, or just a week later, I get invited to go round to Paul's house. I'd been round to his house a few times to cut his hair, blow dry his hair. He suddenly said to me, Leslie, in a couple of week after next, are you doing anything? And I said, no, meaning I'm not doing anything mad. I'm just going to work. He said, we're going on a coach trip and we'd like you to be part of the crew. You could do our hair and would you like to come? I couldn't believe actually what he was saying, because I was just thinking to myself, you know, is he asking me to go on a tour with the Beatles? You know, I knew they quit at Candlestick Park, but to be with four Beatles. So I sort of said, yes, of course I'm going. Well, I couldn't quite understand that, you know, Mr. Epstein died on August 27th, and 2 weeks later, on September the 11th, then we are going to go on the Magical Mystery Tour. Actually, I didn't even know it was called the Magical Mystery Tour. It just sort of said, will you turn up at a place called Allsop Place, which is right next to Madame Tussauds, which is off Baker Street. It's often where the coaches used to park their cars to let people go into Madame Tussauds. So I said, yeah, I'm really excited, because this is I can't tell anybody. One of the great secrets of I learned at Vidal's when I was working and working with the Beatles, I kept my mouth shut. I never told the press I was doing the hair. I never told them I'm going to meet McCartney at 10:30, supposed to be at Allsop Place. I get there actually about 9 o'clock, thinking I'm just going to see what's going on. I can't quite believe that this is all going to happen. When I arrive there, I see Paul McCartney and a guy called Ivor Cutler, who plays Mr. Blunt Vessel, is just sitting on the pavement, leaning against the the metal railings. I'm giving another look there, and I'm just thinking to myself, my God, you know, this is early in the morning. There are people going to work who actually took a double look and went, is that Paul McCartney sitting on the floor? No, it can't be. And this is at a time when, you know, the Beatles are still really big. You know, it's not as if it was sort of waning, which it never did, but it was the Beatles are big. And what was amazing to see, it was people would walk by, go back and say, are you really you? And he would very nicely give autographs and everything. I introduced myself. Then we sort of gave a good morning to everybody, asking what was happening. He said, Leslie, we're just waiting for the coach to turn up. So we waited and waited. It's now getting about 45 minutes afterwards. There's no coach. And Paul just suddenly said, you know, he got up. Obviously, he's looking for where the coach is. There was Mal Evans, the road manager who did everything, was sort of just looking around. And he turned around and said, Mal, where's the coach? He said, don't know. Well, he said, sort it out, find out what's happening. In between that, he said, Leslie, do you want to go and have a cup of tea? Across the road where the transport workers were there. Yeah, why not? Fancy a cup of tea why not? And everything was so sort of natural. The funny thing is, we go inside the transport cafe, and these guys have just worked on a night shift, and in comes the last thing they expect is Paul McCartney to walk in. So we sit down, we have a cup of tea there. We did have a couple of press people follow us, obviously. And there's a picture of me with Paul McCartney and the waitress sitting there having a cup of tea. So this was all going on. This is all a bit surreal. We leave there, the coach still hasn't turned up, and then he disappears, Paul. And so I found out that he'd gone into Soho to get the drivers and the couriers' costumes, which they hadn't even organized yet. finally, the coach turns up at 10:30, and then the other Beatles, the three other Beatles, live down in Virginia Water, which is about 10:30, which is about half an hour away. And we suddenly were just on the coach, and there was loads of different people. There was 43 people on that coach. You had the driver and the courier. You have some members of the British fan, of the Beatles fan club, and there was the other people that Paul had organised. I'm getting a feedback. I don't know if you can hear that.
Well, you're fine, Leslie.
Okay, I'm really hearing it. I don't know. Sorry. Okay, and so we get on the coach and we start driving, and there was Paul with a director. His name was Peter, and they sort of had a blank piece of paper, Paul had a piece of paper, and they sort of saying, what do we do? And we're all sitting on the coach. One of the funniest things is one of my clients is a lady called Shirley Evans. And Shirley, I used to do Shirley Evans for her hair a long time. She was an accordionist, she used to play the accordion. And I used to say to her, you know, where you're playing. She was the sort of music halls. And she said to me one day, she said, Leslie, I've got to tell you something. I'm going on a coach trip with the Beatles. I can't tell anybody. And I whispered to her and I said, Shirley, you never guess what? I'm also going on a coach trip with the Beatles. I'm not telling anybody but you. So we sat on the coach together. It was great to see her on the coach. We get on the coach there. There's film cameraman there. Paul's talking to the director. And we finally get down to, just before that happened, Neil Aspinall gave us £5 each to spend. That was our wages. That was our pocket money to food. Can you imagine £5 to last 4 or 5 days? He gave that to us. And then we drive down to Virginia Water. And we get down there, and there was Ringo, George, and John. John walks on the coach with a feather in his hat and a little hat. George is walking on, and they all look a bit sort of not as bouncy as what Paul looked like, because he was like busy, and you know. And I'm all the time I'm thinking in my head that you know, their manager of all these years, who found them and discovered them, has died less than 2 weeks ago. So, okay, we get on the trip there, and we start heading towards, we don't quite know where we're going, but the whole thing was we're heading down south, down to Devon and Cornwall, the south west of England. And what's going to happen? No one knows what's going to happen. First thing I see what's happening is Ringo sitting on the front of the coach with his aunt Jess, which was scripted as it went along. But it was a lot of shouting and laughing going on. They seem to have a really good time. Paul sat with John, and we didn't have any particular places. So I ended up a lot of the time sitting behind John because I was asked to look after a little baby girl there called Nikki, little baby Nikki, who funny enough, I met in Chicago about 18 months ago. She's a little bit grown up, but she was 5 or 6 years old then. And she was sitting on my knee, and then she was going to her mum, who was there at the same time. And every time she's, you know, as we're driving, she's sort of getting fidgety, as little girls do. And a lot of the time, John was sort of nodding off with his head, you know, and leaning on George's head. And then George was by the window, and he suddenly was, you know, going to sleep and waking up. Filming was going on the whole time, but you weren't aware of what was going on. But in between everything else, little Nikki decided to pull the feather from John's hat, which was quite funny because he used to wake him up. And in Lennon's sort of funny way, he said, Leslie, to turn around and said, Leslie, we control your that little girl, please. And we used to go, yes, John, we'll do that for you. And, you know, it was all, you know, no one knew what was happening. So, you know, that was the first impression I got on the coach from Baker Street, Allsop Place, down to Virginia Water, heading towards Devon. Interesting.
Now, when you look back on that, Leslie, let me ask you. At the time, of course, you're in the moment, but no one knew they were in the moment until, let's say, what was it like when the film was actually released? I think it was what? Christmas Day or something?
Boxing Day.
Boxing Day, and unfortunately, yeah, it wasn't a big hit on the TV. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, you know, the thing is, it's not like today. There were two channels, you know, and each channel would have an audience of, you know, of 20 million or something, you know. So, if, for instance, when the Beatles appeared at Sunday Night at London Palladium, which they topped, you know, which was always on a Sunday night, you'd get an audience of 20 million people. So you thought they would get a big audience, but the problem was that they decided to show it on the afternoon in black and white. Now, the whole thing was when Paul saw Ken Keyes's Merry Pranksters, you know, their coach, which was the Futura, you know, that was all about, you know, acid parties and color and psychedelia. And hence the Magical Mystery Tour coach was slightly psychedelia. Everything the Beatles were doing at the time was psychedelic. So the whole sort of crescendo of the Magical Mystery Tour coming on TV sort of was like a damp squid, you know, black and white, doesn't quite come out. The only thing that comes out of that particular day was the songs, because people, whatever was going on, couldn't wait to hear the next Beatles song. So you get songs like The Fool on the Hill, I'm a Walrus. You know, these are completely different types of songs from the, you know, She Loves You, Yeah, Yeah. So that was a great thing, but it was disappointing that it was in black and white. And actually, it didn't come over very well. It got bad reviews, but, you know, it's something that should have been sorted out at the time. But I think the whole making of the Magical Mystery Tour was improvised. And maybe, you know, if Mr. Epstein was around, maybe it would have gone out in color. Maybe it wouldn't have gone out in black and white. So you can't do everything. But, you know, when you see it in black and white and then see it in color, you'll see the difference. You see the color come out. The music fits in. The clothes fit in. There's a lot of clothes there from the Apple shop that was designed. Velvet jackets. George Harrison wearing oversized jackets, meditating in a field that, which was quite amazing. It was just, you know, the whole thing was a journey that was magic for me and the other people that were on it.
I'll just say, Natalie, if you've got any questions, or Mr. Shampoo or Paul, Leslie will answer.
Well, Leslie, I heard this story one time that, you know, you were in Paul's house and you were left alone, and you decided to get cheeky and try on the Sergeant Pepper jacket, which I thought was just wonderful. I mean, who gets to try on the jacket? And
well, actually, that was what happened was the premiere of the party for the Magical Mystery Tour was at the Royal Lancaster Hotel, and I'd gone round to their house when he was with Jane, and I could see that there was costumes around. You know, I didn't know at the time they were going to wear a Pearly Queen and King, which is which the Cockney guys wear and their ladies wear in the East End, and it's a ritual. You know, you wear Pearly Queen jacket, hat, and everything. And I saw that around, but I didn't think that was necessary. I didn't know what they were going to do with it. And he said to me, "You're coming tonight?" So I said, "Yeah, yeah." He said, "What are you going as?" And I said, "Oh," he said, "it's fancy dress." I went, "Oh, dear me, right. I'm not going in fancy dress." And he actually said to me, "Why don't you go upstairs and see if there's something you like?" Which, even by me saying that to you now, is what happened at the time. And so I went upstairs and I opened the wardrobe, and there it was, the old blue Sergeant Pepper jacket. And I'm looking at it, I'm thinking, "Oh, I can't believe this." So I looked around like I was stealing. I sort of put my head around that way, make sure no one was looking at me. And there was a mirror there. So I put it on, and I was a Sergeant Pepper for a second or two. I suddenly thought to myself, "You can't just wear this. This is not on." So anyway, I took it off, put it back in the wardrobe, went downstairs, and I said, "You know what, Paul, you know, I think I'm going to go as I normally go." So he didn't, you know, wasn't anything to do with him. But actually, I used to have all my suits that I wore were velvet. So I would have a bright green velvet jacket and trousers and a chocolate brown one and maroon. I had a choice because at the shop that we had at the time in the King's Road, a guy called John Crittle was making all these fantastic jackets for Brian Jones, Jimi Hendrix, and me. So, you know, I didn't go I wore what I wanted to wear, and that's. But to try on the Sgt. Pepper jacket, yeah, it was a nice little touch.
That's a great story. I have two more questions, and then I'll let anybody else talk. But I always wanted to ask you, on the Sgt. Pepper album, the Beatles, they changed their hairstyle. They went from mop tops to a more of a layered haircut. Did you cut their hair for that album? Because their hair is all a different texture on that album.
The answer is slightly yes and no, because that was I cut Paul's hair from September 66. I cut his hair short, which is, as our great friend Ivor Davis would say, that's another story. I cut Paul's hair short for the Sgt. Pepper one, yeah. Did the others follow? John had his hair cut short because he did How I Won the War, so he had short hair. If I can remember, George's was not too short, but I didn't particularly cut their hair for that. I never cut the Beatles' hair for any specific reason. I never had the Beatles ever say to me, or any of their management ever say to me, you want it cut like this. It was always how it was at the time. So that's how it was.
Well, my third question, Leslie, was, it's a pleasure to meet you because I've been a stylist all my life and I trained with Vidal Sassoon Academies, where you didn't go to the academies, you got to train with Vidal. And, you know, one man revolutionized the whole industry of hair. Did he ever meet the Beatles or did he ever like them? Can you tell me that?
I could tell you that there was a club in London called the Ad Lib Club, and I was just a little bit too young to hear that. Actually, I'm getting this mad feedback again. Okay, so there was a club in London called the Ad Lib Club, which I was a little bit too young. I think I was 15, 16. I wasn't allowed there, but I used to work with a stylist called Ricky Burns. He used to do the hair of Dusty Springfield, Lulu, and people. But when you're a junior and when you come back on a Monday morning, you know he's talking to his clients and he would be going to the Ad Lib. And I know for a fact that he was, you know, going there and he'd meet Ringo, and Vidal would go there. So Vidal definitely met the Beatles there, probably socialized with them, but he didn't end up cutting their hair.
Fantastic. Now, I just want to ask, Natalie, have you got a question to ask Leslie?
Well, you know what? This discussion has been incredibly insightful. I'm just fascinated to hear any stories that may have stood out to you, either during the time of filming Magical Mystery Tour or any other experience you may have had working in your industry. To clarify, I'm actually the daughter of a hairstylist, so I'm actually fascinated to hear some of your perspective in either vein, depending on what you'd like to share.
Okay, well, I'll show you a lovely story that happened in the Magical Mystery Tour that was just completely off the cuff. We did a day's filming. There was a guy called Spencer Davis, had a great hit called Keep On Running, and he suddenly appeared down in Cornwall, and I know he must have spoke to Mal Evans, who then spoke to Paul, and said that his relative has a pub just not far from where we were, would he like to come along? So during we finished filming about a couple of hours later, I think we had dinner at the hotel, and Paul just said, fancy coming down to the pub? And he said it to me, he said it to a lovely lady called Miranda Ward, who did an interview with George Harrison, Ringo, myself, and we went down to the pub. Can you imagine, this is a Cornish pub, the guys there finished their day's work, whatever they're doing, they've got their pints, and in comes Paul McCartney and Ringo Starr. And it was just so funny to watch because, they probably thought they had too much to drink because, let alone seeing one Beatle, they probably had double vision. There was Paul and Ringo. And they had a piano there. What they call a honky-tonk piano, and Paul sat down, somebody gave him a pint, and it's obvious, if someone shouted, go on, give us a version of Yellow Submarine or do something, but he didn't, he played everything but a Beatles song. On the wall was a one-stringed mandolin that Ringo picked up, and I think we've had a few drinks for that time. We weren't sort of, you know, a couple of pints or two or whatever. And you had Paul playing the honky-tonk piano, and you had Ringo plucking away on the old mandolin there. That went on for a couple of hours, an hour, hour and a half, and then we left. Again, we didn't tell anybody. You know, I didn't tell anybody, and it was one of those off-the-cuff things that just happened. So, no one knew about that until, I think, Miranda Ward, bless her, she told that story because she's a journalist, and I'm not. So that was a really nice story.
Leslie, I just want to say, if Paul's got any questions for you, he can. If not, I just want to say it's been a pleasure having you on the show and speaking about the Magical Mystery Tour. And I tell you, when I open up that Beatle EP and I see the photo of you in it, and I mean, such a buzz to be embedded at that time in 1967 on that bus and on that Magical Mystery Tour, to me, it's mind-blowing. And as I said, like Paul doing the tour now of the 60s, and I mean, you being part of that as well. I mean, it's mind-blowing too. When you look back to 67 and now you look at the internet, technology, and what you can do, you can be in London and you don't even leave your own home. I mean, isn't that right, Paul?
Paulie, I'll answer him. I think he hasn't got his headphones working.
Oh, I just want to say, for everybody out there, make sure you check out the tour. And there you go, www.60sbus.london. Check it out. Is there anything you'd like to say, Paul, before we go? Okay, all I want to say to everybody out there. Tell everyone about your book.
Have a great time. You know, stay safe.
Okay, I'm just going to say, Natalie and anybody out there, I mean, there are so many stories that that I never told for a long, long time. You know, I'm not very good at publicizing it, but I'm going to put the book up. It's all in my book, The Cutting Edge, and there are loads and loads of stories there. And you can get it from beatlesstore.com. You can get it from my website, www.beatlesstore.com. And you can message me, and only too happy to answer any questions. And also just must say, Paul's, I've done a few tours with Paul. I've listened, I've been a passenger, I've talked about it. And it does, it brings it back to London, you know, alive. You can't get out there now. And I give it, Paul drives around, he shows it, he's patient, and we go to places that you wouldn't normally see in West London. You see Liverpool, I can take you to Soho on my tours, and I can take you all Abbey Road, I can take you to all these places. But West London seems to sort of miss out a little bit, and it shouldn't do, because it's the home of people like Zeppelin, who recorded at a place called Olympic Studios, which is a massive place where all these great people. So yeah, check it out, West London Beatle Tours tomorrow. Look forward to it. Thank you.
Right, I just want to say thank you, Leslie, thank you, Paul, thank you, Mr. Shampoo, thank you, Natalie. And I just want to say to everybody, stay groovy, because we love you.
Take you.
Hey, bananas, you think you're groovy?
You think you're groovy?
Hey, bananas, we watch a movie.
Watch a movie, yeah.
Driving dune buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey, bananas,
we think you're groovy.